nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 1.5. So in the last lecture, we just explained how reciprocal lattice vectors work, and before that, we were talking about 1D band structures. So now we're going to use that new tool of reciprocal lattice vectors to actually calculate 2D band structures properly. And so, of course, we already remember that we wrote down Schrodinger's equation as a band structure problem, and then we obtained a recursion relation using Fourier analysis. And now we're going to extend the same kind of approach to photonic band structures. So now we're writing down what we call the photonic master equation, which we can actually derive by combining Ampere's law with Maxwell's correction, or including displacement current, in other words, as well as Faraday's law. And so if we combine those correctly, then you can imagine that we get a single equation, which is second order in H. And of course, we could construct an analogous equation E, but the value of doing an H specifically is that we always know that divergence of B and thus divergence of H in most media would be zero, right? Because we have no free magnetic monopoles. And so when we actually rewrite H as a block solution, which remember is essentially a periodic function times a plane wave, and then we also write down that periodic function as sum over g of hg times e to the ig dot r, then we get something like a sum over g hg to the e to the I k plus g dot r for our solutions. And then if we actually apply the curl and epsilon inverse operators in the Fourier domain, then that actually gives us an equation that looks like this. Okay, so you can kind of see how that matches up, especially like after we've dropped all the sums and stuff. So this is kind of the simplest possible representation. And remember that we had this complex exponential, so that's like why each of the curls was converted into k plus g or k plus g prime. And we have to adjust for the difference between g and g prime on the two sides. So that's why we got a few different indices. So this basically becomes like a big matrix problem at this point. So that's what this is showing, big matrix problem. So we've taken something that could initially be very scary looking because it has a bunch of operators and we don't know how to solve it except in really simple cases. But now we have it written down in a form that's general enough so we can actually solve it using a numerical approach. And so you can actually download the software MIT Photonic Bands located at this website, or you can use the nanohub.org tool, which implements MPB, which is at nanohub.org/tools/MPB. And then you can actually use it yourself without any installation. You just need a free account. And so anyway, so remembering that we need to look at the irreducible Brillouin zone for a 2D or 3D problem in order to really understand its behavior, then we have to first just define some notation, which is the high symmetry wave vector values. And so basically at certain k values, like k equals 0, we define it to be gamma. K equals pi over a, we define it to be x. So I'm not going to just read all of those off, but you can certainly read those, and they're on the PDF if you need to refer back to it. And so in the case of the square lattice of dielectric rods that we want to simulate, basically you can see it looks like this. The kind of the green rods are alternating high dielectric region, all separated by air. Then we have this overall Brillouin zone, which of course is a square because it's a square lattice. But then we also can use symmetries to reduce the whole system to this like small triangle that's 1/8 of our original area. And then within that area, we have those three high symmetry points that are of interest, gamma, x, and m, where m is equal to pi over a and pi over a in the x and y directions. And so what we see actually is very interesting, which is that depending on the symmetry of the problem, whether it's transverse magnetic, which means all the H fields are in the plane of the board, or if it's transverse electric, where all the E fields are in the plane of the board, we actually get much different solutions. And furthermore, there's a so-called band gap or range of values where no frequencies are allowed, which is analogous to what we talked about before, the forbidden modes, but it's only happening for the TM modes. Okay, so only when the magnetic field is in the plane. If it's out of the plane, we don't have that anymore in this kind of system. And so just to quickly visualize what this field profile looks like, you can actually see here explicitly that in the first band at X, that you actually have kind of this X periodicity, but then the localization in different regions is actually much different. So you actually have an exclusion from the high index region here. So that contributes to higher energy in the band gap. And similarly, same thing is happening over here. You have like localization versus exclusion from the high index regions, which is giving us a physical picture of that band gap that we had previously talked about in the 1D case. Also happens in 2D case over a broad range of wave vectors. In the next lecture, we'll go into more details about how to solve other kinds of 2D band structure type problems.